very much. Two people who can't be here tonight, Elise Jaffe and Jeffrey Brown, who are some of the foremost patrons of architecture, both contemporary and historical, in New York. Okay, so welcome in the snowy morning of now our late winter, of our discontent, at least about winter. Welcome back for the second session for some of the now familiar faces, in order to roll back to the earliest 1870s, the very first of the 10-story buildings, and the age of masonry transitioning into steel. So the topic of the birth of the skyscraper, the first skyscraper, the technology that may define the skyscraper, or the height that may be the defining characteristic of the skyscraper, is a debate that has been waged between New York and Chicago historians, at least, from at least the 1950s. And I'm not sure if how deeply steeped you are in the historiography of the skyscraper, and Don Friedman is going to recap it for us, and from his point of view, I think. But going back to the 1950s, you can go back to the 1850s too, but in the 1950s, an architectural historian named Winston Weissman wrote about the New York skyscraper in order to rebut, I guess, Carl Condit and a kind of, marshaling and corralling of the definition of the skyscraper, placing it squarely in the invention and location of Chicago. And Weissman kind of fought back with an argument about the first skyscrapers being in New York. And I want to praise him now, because on rereading, so I read him 30 years ago or so when I started on this inquiry of the skyscraper and its history, and I diverged in my own thinking about issues about first and technology. But in rereading Winston Weissman, I rediscovered a kind of logic, a logical eye that he brought to the argument that's completely praiseworthy, and I think we should read him more often now. And one of the things that he talked about at the very end of one essay is, incidentally, let's not forget that all of these buildings were, that their purpose of being was commercial architecture. And that was something that got lost in the argument about technology versus tall that I think defines the principal narrative of the early high-rise. But we're going to revisit all of those things in today's discussion and debate. So we're going to begin with the home team of New York, with Donald Friedman, who you now have all heard. If you're here for the first time, maybe you haven't heard him before. But Don is the raison d'etre for the exhibition that you see around you, 10 and Taller, because he did spend 10 plus years of researching part-time, obsessively, in order to answer questions for himself and then to offer the data to us all about how did they build the first skyscrapers? What were the systems? What was the logic? What were the problems they were trying to solve? And that's some of the perspective that he's going to give us. And some of you may have heard Tom Leslie's talk about, when I was going to hold their books up, on Wednesday night, about his book Chicago Skyscrapers that you see right here. And presumably he's going to say something different enough today that if you went to the first one, you will not feel too much repetition. And this is Don's, most recent book until this one comes out, which is the study that informed the material of the exhibition. So this one coming out next year is called Structure in Skyscrapers, History and Preservation. And this one is Historical Building Construction. If you're not familiar with it, available in the store. So I guess without further ado, we're going to let Don define the skyscraper for us, and then we'll start with the Chicago team. Oh, and let me just say, because before I sit down, I want to thank very much Elise Jaffe and Jeffrey Brown, who are great patrons of architecture, both historical and contemporary, for supporting the symposium. They weren't able to be with us because they've got too many other things that they support, and they work as well. So in their absence, we just want to say, hey, shout out to Elise and Jeff. Okay.
I'm going to begin with what they refer to in internet movie reviews as a spoiler. My conclusion is that there is no such thing as the first skyscraper. So don't leave, because I'm going to describe how I got to that conclusion. Ancillary to that is that the first skyscraper that doesn't exist was built in New York. So I hope that clarifies everything. Hey, this is where you need to start. Because skyscraper is a word that basically can mean anything we want it to mean. If you said you were interested in what's the first 16-story building, we can find that out. We can go look at all the old buildings and, you know, count rows of windows, and you'll find the first one that had 16 floors. That's because 16 floors is a more or less objective criterion, whereas skyscraper is a word that can sort of mean whatever we want. There is one objective definition for it. That red triangle is outlining a stay sail located above the Royal Stay Sail, and that is where the word skyscraper originated. So that is that the laser? No.
Should be there.
That's the laser. There's the only objective, the only definition of skyscraper that is purely objective, cannot be argued with. I find it less than helpful. For buildings, you're going to find definitions that range from 8 stories to 300 meters as the lower cutoff. If you say that no building is a skyscraper unless it's 300 meters tall, you're limiting yourself to a very small number of buildings. But I have seen that definition, and it's a way to make sure you have the latest and greatest. Part of the problem with this, and it actually goes back well before the 1950s, what Carol was talking about, as early as 1899, William LeBaron Jenney, who was the designer of the Home Insurance Building in Chicago, and Bradford Lee Gilbert, who was the designer of the Tower Building in New York, built 1885 and 1889, respectively, got into a public argument about who designed the first skyscraper. They both felt that they had done it. This is 1899. What's fascinating is that the propaganda that Jenney was spreading at that time, I think they're both wrong, I should add that. The propaganda that Jenny was spreading at the time is exactly what has people today convinced that the Home Insurance Building was the first skyscraper. I've stopped participating in these arguments. They lead nowhere. Or to put it another way, the etymological root of the word fan is fanatic. If somebody has a particular building you're interested in, I'd love to talk to you about in the Q&A at the end of all of this. I don't think that we get very far by looking at individual buildings. We have to look at some criteria. So how do we define the word skyscraper? Because that's how you're going to try to figure out which building is the first skyscraper if such a thing exists. So I would argue the most important thing is that it be tall.
You say that as a tall person.
I say that as a tall person. I have it on good authority that in 1906, a 7-story building in Kansas City was considered to be a skyscraper. As it turns out, Mr. Rogers and Mr. Hammerstein misled me, because in 1890 there was a 10-story building in Kansas City. What's very interesting about that is that 10-story building built in 1890 in Kansas City, the first skyscraper in Kansas City, I would argue, was designed by the New Yorkers McKim, Mead, and White for their client, the New York Life Insurance Company. The New York Life Insurance Company was also responsible for the only 10-story building prior to 1900 in Omaha. They also built one of the 3 10-story tall buildings in Minneapolis before 1900, and one of 3 in St. Paul. There's a whole discussion about cultural imperialism that we can have here, about the New Yorkers going around the Midwest and planting skyscrapers to represent themselves. It doesn't get us any closer to the first skyscraper, but it is sort of an interesting side note. So why am I talking about 10 stories? In my research that led to, well, my research that I would say inspired this exhibition, it didn't lead to this exhibition, I've been using 10 stories as a lower cutoff. I think that's a good height. It's definitely arguable. And you can do this, you have to look at what era you're talking about and what location you're talking about. 7 stories is something that is considered to be sort of the maximum people are willingly going to go up a flight of stairs. And there are relatively few examples of occupied buildings taller than 7 stories prior to the invention of the elevator. 10 stories in the 1880s was enough to get people's attention. And that leads me to the concept that tall is it's very much a contextual thing. It's tall for the era in the location. A 10-story building in New York today, I've seen people refer to them as low-rises, right? 10 stories in 1880 would be among the tallest buildings in New York. So time and location. In 2013, Tom Leslie wrote an op-ed piece for the New York Times arguing for a different definition of height than the one currently used by the Council on Tall Buildings and Urban Habitat when they try to determine which is the tallest building around. And one of the problems is a lot of buildings have stuff up at the top. Is that part of the floor count or not? It is a full story higher than the main roof. It's this little appendage. That's actually occupiable space. What do you do if you have an unoccupiable spire? Where is the top of the Chrysler Building, for example? Where's the top of the Empire State Building? Top of the Empire State Building, there's a roof at the 86th floor. Then there's a thing, which one could argue is a dirigible mooring mast, although I do not. And then there's another floor, the top observation deck. And that's where the building used to stop, and then there's a bunch of antennas sticking up. I can think of at least 4 different locations you could say is the top of the Empire State Building. So height is subjective. And that was, Tom was arguing for a different subjective definition than the one that the Council on Tall Buildings currently uses. Perfectly legitimate thing to argue. Height is not enough. Why isn't this a skyscraper? It's 40 stories tall, or the equivalent of 40 stories tall, I should say. It's a very tall structure.
It's the tallest building in the world until 1855.
There you go. So I would say that most of you, if not all of you, agree with me that that's not a skyscraper. Great Pyramid of Pizza, not a skyscraper. Why isn't it a skyscraper? And I'm pretty sure that most of you could give me reasons. I want to give you my logic because that gets into, again, how we define tall buildings. This sounds ridiculous when I say this. I have people think I'm crazy when I say this. One of the things that taught me to not get into arguments on the internet was a discussion of the distinction between a tall building and a tower. The CN Tower in Toronto, for example. The Eiffel Tower, which I'm going to be showing you a picture of shortly. Are those things buildings or not? And of course, it depends on how you define building, it depends on how you define tower. It also is related to language. The person I got into I think it was an incredibly stupid argument, and I was one of the participants, was Romanian. And English was her third or fourth language. And she said to me that in Romania, the difference between building and tower is not as distinct as it is in English. I said, well, that may be part of why we're arguing. That is the tallest building in Manhattan up until 1890, Trinity Church. And as you can see, it got overtopped pretty readily in the 1890s. 280-foot spire. Why isn't that a skyscraper? And in the pre-skyscraper New York era, tourists would go up the tower of Trinity Church because there was a great view from up there. Now, I've been up in that tower. There's a great view through windows that are about this big. So it was a very long, exhausting climb for tourists to look through a porthole. But it was a different era then. That spire has no internal floors. It has a stair that has sort of landings off the stair. There's no usable space in that spire. So when I say usable space, I'm trying to exclude something like this. Trinity is effectively a one-story building. It's a very tall one-story building. One way to look at this issue is to use a modern metric, which is floor area ratio. For the people in the room who are not familiar with that, it is the total square footage in the building divided by the lot size. Say for the sake of argument, you have a 100 foot by 100 foot lot, that's 10,000 square feet. If you fill that lot and go 10 stories, you have a 100,000 square foot building divided by a 10,000 square foot lot, you have an FAR of 10. If you cover half the lot and go 10 stories, You have 50,000 square feet divided by a 10,000 foot lot, you have an FAR of 5. Modern zoning in New York, certainly, and I believe other cities as well, uses FAR as one of the ways to measure building bulk. A skyscraper, if it has one way of saying it has usable floors, is to look at its FAR. The usable floor area in Trinity Church is almost exactly the same as the footprint of the building, FAR of 1. And one of the best engineers of the 19th century, two of his towers. And for this discussion, I'm ignoring that. That is a huge glob of concrete and masonry. It's actually closer to the pyramids than anything else built in New York. Above it is a wrought iron skeleton with a copper skin, a supported curtain wall, something that some people feel is very important in a skyscraper. Here we have the skeleton with no curtain wall. Well, the Eiffel Tower has an FAR under 1. The only reason it's that high is that there are here, here, and here, there are some floors. The Statue of Liberty has an FAR of about 0.2. So all that height, but you have a flat surface inside that's less than 20% of the floor area. Again, something we would think of as a skyscraper is going to have an FAR of 10 or more if it's 10 stories. If you have a chimney, you have an FAR of 0. You can build a very tall, there are chimneys in industrial buildings that are, you know, hundreds of feet tall, FAR of 0. So I don't think anything is a skyscraper unless it has usable interior floors that are the reason for the height, getting back to Carol's point about economic use. Neither one of these buildings or these structures was built for economic purposes. They were both built as symbols. And
no,
if you
the Eiffel Tower was built in order to charge people money to go up. That's why it existed.
Yeah, but it didn't make money enough money in the fair to cover its own cost. If it were not a symbol, it would have been torn down, is I guess my argument. Okay. It was never meant as a commercial operation in that sense.
It was still hated.
It was essentially.
Okay, so that gets me through height and interior floors. I want to discuss a somewhat more serious topic. Let's not all die in a fire. That is an early skyscraper in Minneapolis, the Lumber Exchange. It was built as two wings. The first wing was built first with wood joist floors. And what inevitably happens to tall wood frame buildings, it burned. When they rebuilt it, they built it with fireproof floors, the same as the second wing. It's unfortunate that it took that lesson for people to understand why not to do that. Among people who deal with fire professionally, and I'll include firefighters, insurance companies, engineers who do forensic work, it's a commonly stated belief that every wood frame building will eventually burn. Not necessarily burn down, not entirely, but wood structure burns. That's what it does. So building a tall wood frame building is asking for a disaster. Chicago lost a big chunk of the city in 1871. Interestingly, what people don't remember is that in 1872, a chunk of Boston, downtown Boston, burned down. It actually cost the insurance companies more than the Chicago fire because of the, I think it's 17,000 buildings that burned in Chicago. Most of them were wood frame houses that weren't insured. But burned in Boston were big commercial buildings in the center of the city. They were all very heavily insured, the buildings and the contents. So the insurance companies got very wary of non-fireproof buildings, particularly large non-fireproof buildings, and they started doing what insurance companies do. They raised the rent on, they raised their rates on buildings they didn't like. To give you a very specific example of this, it was determined that one of the main mechanisms for fire spread in the Boston fire were wood-framed mansard roofs. And the response from fire insurance companies was to say, if you have a flammable mansard on your building, you're going to pay 5 times as much for fire insurance as if you don't. You could have a non-flammable mansard, that was okay. And the result of that, in Brooklyn, for example, was that all the mansards on brownstones disappeared. If you walk along, I think it's 7th Avenue and Park Slope, south from Flatbush Avenue, there's a block of beautifully preserved brownstones, and one of them has its original mansard, and all the rest of them, they've been removed. And they were removed because the homeowners didn't want to pay insane insurance rates just to have a mansard. So I think you can underestimate the effect of something like an insurance company being upset in terms of the evolution of building technology. There have been all sorts of iron framing, terracotta floors, things like that used in buildings in the 1850s and 60s. People were experimenting. Starting in 1871, it was no longer an experiment. It became a must-do. So, and Tom and I have talked, obviously, about what we're going to talk about today. In general, I'm shying away from technological discussions in defining a skyscraper. My view of defining a skyscraper, it doesn't matter if it's got bearing walls or cast iron or steel. I do, however, say it needs to be what they referred to in the 19th century as modern fireproof structure, which is to say the floors aren't wood joist, because that was a very large driving force in the development. By making that definition, by the way, another one of the arguments I never want to have again, yes, there were 10-story buildings in Edinburgh in the 18th century, and there were 10-story tenements in Rome in the first century, all wood joist construction. So that's my very convenient way of getting rid of those buildings. I've got height, I've got usable floor area, I've got fire resistance. Probably still not enough. I'm going to quote Louis Sullivan. It must be tall, every inch of it tall. The force and power of altitude must be in it. The glory and pride of exaltation must be in it. It must be every inch a proud and soaring thing. That's beautiful poetry. Talking about commercial building. There are all sorts of ways to make something seem tall. You can put vertical stripes on your building, as some architects have done. You can also have a more slender building. It's a very simple optical illusion. If the building is wider than it is tall, it appears shorter than if it's narrower than it is tall. It's really as simple as that. It's the way our eyes function. So in the 1880s, this is home insurance on the left in Chicago, and Temple Court on the right in New York, which has just been turned into the forecourt of a rather tall hotel. They're 10 stories, they're modern fireproof structure, they have usable floors, they meet all those criteria. They're sort of squat. You don't get that soaring feeling looking at them. A few years later, here's the Masonic Temple in Chicago, Park Row Building in New York. They're noticeably taller than they are wide. They seem tall. Now, they're also taller. These two buildings are taller than the ones on the previous slide. But they seem taller. When I put them all at the same scale on the slide, because these are more slender, they look taller. I'm putting it here purely in terms of visual effect. And as a structural engineer, the more slender a structure is, the more difficult it is to make it stand up. And I was thinking about it this morning. There's a thing called the angle of internal friction when you're dealing with soils. And the easiest way of describing it is picture yourself with a bucket of sand at the beach and you very slowly pour it out. And the sand will form a cone on the ground. And the angle of the side of that cone is related to this characteristic of the sand. You can do it with any granular material. And the pyramids are sort of that. The pyramids are sort of, the angle of the pyramid is pretty close to that angle where gravity alone will keep something stable. As opposed to something that is tall and slender, gravity doesn't keep that stable. If the wind blows and you were relying just on gravity, it would tip over. So, I'm trying to think of exactly how to phrase this. I want it to be difficult. I want the design and construction of a skyscraper to be something more difficult than dumping sand out of a bucket. So, the more slender buildings, that is true. A couple of statistics from my research, if you look at 1880 skyscrapers, using my definition of 10 stories and taller usable floors, fireproof, in New York and Chicago, the average slenderness, the height divided by the width, is about 1.8 in the 1880s. That's 14 buildings in Chicago, 28 in New York. Now, as time goes on, they diverge. And partly they diverge because Chicago has a height limit. So if you can't build tall, your buildings are going to tend to have a lower as tall. Your buildings are going to tend to have a lower slenderness. Historically, slenderness on tall buildings topped out at around 10. The Gillander building in New York was near 10. There were a few others that were near 10. Most buildings that we think of as very tall are have a lower slenderness. Empire State Building is around 6 or 7. The old World Trade Center was around 6. Sears Tower is about 6, 6.5. That has to do with the difficulty in keeping a very tall, slender building stiff in the wind. It's okay in terms of structural stress if it's moving, but people don't like that. One of my professors referred to it as white caps in the toilets. People get very upset when they can perceive their building moving. Modern, meaning very recent skyscrapers, we're now up into the 20s because they're relying on active control systems to reduce the feeling of movement. Billionaires Row on 57th Street, there are buildings in the 20s of slenderness, which is why they seem so very, very skinny to us when we look at them. We're used to tall buildings having a slenderness of 10 or less, and now we're seeing buildings that are twice as slender. So I haven't really talked about structure here very much. I mean, I've sort of been talking around it. I'm a structural engineer. You would think this is what I'm most concerned about. There's a very simple deterministic trap that you can't fall into when you're talking about this topic. And that is people did not develop steel framing, which did develop in this era. These two buildings both have structural steel skeleton frames. These two buildings both do not. It developed in this era. People did not develop it so that they could then build tall buildings. They built tall buildings and they wanted to build them taller and cheaper, so they developed steel framing to enable that. The technology came second. So I'm not using this as a criterion. I want to discuss it for a minute. Here is a building with an iron frame supporting a masonry curtain wall. It's a shock tower. And I didn't know what that was, I had to look it up. You dump molten lead at the top, and as it drops through the air, it forms spheres. And at the bottom, depending on how big your drops were, you have buckshot, or I don't know if you can make a cannonball that way, but you can make spheres of lead.
Drop it into water,
yeah. Yes, it would be unfortunate to drop it, on a brick floor. So that's why you have a tall tower, is to let it fall far enough for the air to do its magic and turn the lead into spheres. This is actually a demolition photo, which is why there are holes up on top. I don't think it's a skyscraper. Like a chimney, it's got an FAR of 0. On the other hand, if I could convince somebody with a great deal of money and not common sense to build a 50-story building today using unreinforced masonry bearing walls, which is theoretically possible, you'd want to do it in a city with a low seismic design load. Wouldn't that be a skyscraper? Would anybody say it's not a skyscraper? It's a 50-story building. So obviously, I think people agree with me. Here's a skeleton frame, it's not a skyscraper, and my hypothetical building, which has a skeleton frame, is not. What if we say, in terms of structural technology, we have to have 10 stories, is a cutoff height I've chosen arbitrarily, fireproof structure, usable floors, and a complete steel skeleton frame. Guess what? We have a tie. Building on the left is the Manhattan Building in Chicago, and I will never stop laughing at the fact that that is the name of the building, which was started in June of 1889 and finished in the summer of 1891. Building on the right, which I have carefully adjusted to make it look as if it's the same height, even though it's actually only about two-thirds the height, is the London and Lancashire Building in New York, which was started somewhat later. Started in October of 1889, so it was started 4 months later, 5 months later, and finished in May of 1890, so it was finished sooner. Simultaneous construction. There's no way to say that either one of these buildings influenced the other one. And they're the first two buildings with steel skeleton frames.
Now demolished, but as you can see, right next to Federal Hall on the back side, on the Pine Street side, right?
The Manhattan Building is 16 stories, 210 feet, slenderness of 3.1. London and Lancashire is 10 stories, 118 feet, rather short skyscraper, slenderness of 4.7. And it is, you look at it, that is a skinny building. The street front is just that, right there. Right, that's the side of the building. Nobody believes me when I say this. On an emotional level, I'm very happy about that tie. I feel like it works for me. On a side note, the second lighter building in Chicago was also constructed simultaneously. It's only 8 stories old. You can argue that the second lighter building is an early skyscraper. I tend to exclude it. It's, I don't know, it's a very squat building. A summary of this whole discussion about criteria is to say, if you tell me which criteria you feel are important, I'll tell you which building is the first skyscraper, which suggests that there is no such thing as a first skyscraper, right? If it's all dependent on the selection criteria, then, you know, what does it matter? This is Thomas Nast. Some of you may know him as having helped bring down Boss Tweed and also having invented our modern conception of Santa Claus. Apparently not a fan of tall buildings. For those who can't read the caption, it says New York in a few years from now. And what's funny is that really does look a lot like the tip of Lower Manhattan. He captured it ahead of time, including, you know, his era. You look at the tops of the buildings, that's pretty accurate. How do you decide where to go from here? And something I like to look at when I'm doing research in the history of construction in general, not just skyscrapers, is repetition. There are a lot of things that somebody tried, and it was an experiment, and maybe it worked, and maybe the building still exists, but they never did it again, and nobody ever copied them, and it's what biologists refer to as a sport. It's a one-off, it's a freak, and it doesn't really matter. To give an example of that, there's a building up in Westchester County, which is, you know, people have referred to as the first reinforced concrete building in the United States. It's a house. And it influenced nothing. So it's an interesting building, but it's hard to say it's the first reinforced concrete building when it was a dead end of technology. So if I'm not talking about technology per se, what am I talking about? And let's go back to New York Life planting those skyscrapers across the Midwest. I think New York created what I'm going to call a skyscraper culture. And the idea was that anybody who owned a piece of land could build a skyscraper. There was nothing stopping them. This isn't real. This is. Let's start with the one on the right, because that's the more normal building. This is the Shoe and Leather Bank building, the corner of Broadway and Chambers. If you know the Broadway Chambers building, this was directly south of it across Chambers Street. It's 25 feet wide, 12 real stories. That's a ridiculously skinny building. It's a one-lot building. There's nothing like this elsewhere. My favorite building, this is the Manis building, named after its developer, Mr. Manis. In case you're wondering, that is the front of the building, right there. Manis building is 16 feet wide, or what, 16 feet wide, 11 stories tall, roughly 60 feet long, FAR of 10, slenderness of 8.3. This building is insane. This building should never have been built. Mr. Manis owned a very small piece of land and believed it was his right to develop it to the fullest extent possible, and he built this building, which lasted for about 20 years. If you think about it, at 16 feet by 60 feet, that's an office for two people on one floor, because you have to take out a stair and an elevator shaft. I'm sure the stairs were very steep and the elevator was very small. The logical thing to do if you own that piece of land would be to erect a two-story taxpayer and have a hot dog stand at the ground level. But in the culture of 1890s New York, Mr. Manis said, I'm going to build a skyscraper. Looking at the numbers, there were 22 buildings in New York 25 feet wide or less and 10 stories tall or more, built before 1900. There were no such buildings built anywhere else in the country. So there was this idea that if you had a piece of land, you would build a skyscraper. So now I've sort of reached my end here. What building meets all these criteria. And or the ones I've defined, how are you going to do it? This is Tribune on the left, Western Union on the right, 1874, 1875, about a block apart at the foot of City Hall Park in New York. They are noticeably taller than anything that followed them for about 10 years or so. Western Union has, see that mansard roof? That's basically a three-story high wrought iron skeleton frame structure because there are no bearing walls up there. So there's the beginning of the skeleton frame idea here, even though this is 1875, this is 15 years before the Manhattan Building and the London and Lancashire Building. So they're very much taller than everything around them. Even after other skyscrapers start getting built in New York, these buildings were noticeably tall for quite some time because they were so much taller than everything that came before them, and everybody noticed it. It's not like these buildings were snuck into Manhattan and nobody realized they were there. So on the basis of height, slenderness, you notice, taller than it is wide by a good amount. Modern fireproof technology, as it was called at the time. This is all usable space except for the very top of the towers. These seem to me to be the earliest buildings that are exhibiting all of the signs of being skyscrapers. It's unfortunate that there's no such thing as a first skyscraper because then these would win. That's where I've got to, and I'm not sure there's anything else to say on the topic. Thank you.
Just to note the historiography, Winston Weissman called those two buildings, the Tribune and the Western Union Building, the first skyscrapers as well. In addition, the Equitable Building, which does not conform, he says the Equitable Building, 1870, because it's an elevator building and an office building, is the first of the three of the trio of proto skyscrapers, he actually calls them.
Yes.
And I agree because of the FAR, I would disqualify it. So I totally agree with.
Equitable is six stories, and it's wider than it is tall. It doesn't meet some of my.
And it's got an atrium goes right through the middle of it, right? So its FAR is very low.
And I just want to, there's all sorts of ways to, as I hope I've made clear, to slice up this data. I'm deliberately ignoring structure, except for saying fireproof, and that's a decision that I've made, and I hope you understand why. I believe Tom may disagree with it.
Maybe.
Well, we're going to set up, Josh, can you set up the next PowerPoint, and maybe like one or two.
Who has a burning question that can't wait
for the
end.
Discussion, because I need to arrange the lunch, the sandwich lunches.
Where do you see Leroy Buffington?
I'm not allowed to say in a straitjacket, right?
He did get a patent for it.
For the people who can't hear, the question was, where do I see Leroy Buffington? Buffington was a Minnesotan who got a patent on what he considered to be skeleton frame technology. In 1888, I believe, the patent was awarded.
But he claims to have thought of it in 1881.
Well, I've thought of a lot of things, but I can't prove it. He never built that patent, built on that patent. Nobody ever built on that patent, because if you take a good look at it, it is unbuildable. Buffington had a core of cast iron columns and very traditional framing, and the exterior of his building had steel plates as bracing wrapping around the building, sort of spiral. If you picture something like the Gherkin in London, only instead of the window mullions, they're big steel plates. That was his idea for bracing this building. And he then had a very thin skin over that. I don't believe it could have been built. I don't believe it would have resisted wind load very well, and I think it would have leaked like a sieve. I think had he ever tried to build it, or anybody else ever tried to build it, we would have proof of that. There's an obvious experiment here for somebody with a lot of money to burn. But the answer is that Buffington made a claim that he could not in any way support. And in the field of building design and construction, my sympathies are with people who've actually built something, because they can point at what they built and say, here, I proved it. So, you know, and I was sort of dumping on William LeBaron Jenny earlier. Jenny built a lot of buildings, and he could back up his assertions about how things worked by saying, look at my building. Buffington could not do that. His practice was low-rise buildings. And the fact that he got this patent is a sort of historical curiosity. But no more than that, what's most interesting about this is that when Tom and I did the same kind of debate 3.5 years ago in Chicago, for some reason, Minneapolis was represented. So I actually removed from my slide deck the slides where I attack Buffington. I had them from 3.5 years ago, and I removed them for today because I said nobody wants to talk about Buffington.
Isn't his image, in fact, the first description of a bundled tube construction that was used by the original World Trade Center?
No. Okay. It's physically very different. He was doodling some interesting stuff. Had he tried to build it, he would have found out it didn't work. That's where I come down on him. You know, again, opinions may differ, but you're asking me, so that's...
Yeah.
I think, are we ready for Tom?
We are, and okay. So there's some standees that I'll just give them a moment to seat while Tom gets organized. There's some seats in the front right here, people can get in, reach into them, and Tom's seat is now available.
Oh, true. Okay.
Yeah.
Well, you're sitting there, can I sit here?
Yeah, sure. And kind of introduce yourself. So.
Well, thank you so much. I'm delighted to be here in slightly hostile territory. Someone on my way in said, don't worry, you know, we'll grant you safe passage. And I thought, tough crowd. So I'll start by saying I agree with Don that there was no such thing as the first skyscraper. And I'm going to disagree with Don by saying it was built in Chicago. So what I want to do today is I want to go back and I want to look a little bit at the historiography, because we do agree that the question, even though, as we were saying last night, it's a kind of pointless question, but it's interesting in its pointlessness. And if you kind of unpack the history of the debate, you get at, I think, some very, very interesting technical points about tall building construction that we don't often have the excuse to kind of talk about. So I'm going to respectfully disagree with my colleague. And you know, along the way, I think I want to point out some of the things that go into tall building that we sometimes take for granted. So as Carol mentioned, there's a long history of this kind of discussion about what's the first skyscraper and where does it happen? Does it happen in New York or Chicago? Minneapolis, I think we agree, that's ridiculous, right? But New York and Chicago are always the two that are claimed. And this question really goes back, as I'll show, goes back to the 1890s. But the first time historians begin to really look at this in detail is when Francisco Mojica writes this book, The History of the Skyscraper, in 1929. And he defines it as a building of great height constructed on a steel skeleton and, this is for Lee Gray, provided with high-speed electric elevators. Right? That's the only definition I can find that includes elevators. And he says it's the Masonic Temple, which Don showed, which I'll talk about a little bit in a minute. Thomas Talmadge, who writes in 1940, this is his, Talmadge was elderly by then. He'd been party to a number of developments in Chicago. And he said a tall building is skeleton construction, and he says it's home insurance. And this has traditionally been Chicago's argument. If you're a second or third grader in Chicago, you grew up knowing that William LeBaron Jenny woke up one morning and invented the skyscraper in Chicago in 1884, right? Winston Wiseman, as Carol said, comes back in 1953 and says that's ridiculous. The definition really is a tall office building, right? Doesn't really matter what goes into it. And he says that it's the Western Union Building by George Post, 1873, 1875, or maybe the Tribune Building by Hunt. And the kind of the parlay back is J. Carson Webster, who's a professor at Northwestern with Carl Condit. Condit is very careful about making any claims for firsts, but Webster sort of takes on the task and says, a very tall building of skeleton construction arranged in stories. So he's trying to get around the problem of the Eiffel Tower. And so he says that it has to be arranged in stories, it has to be of skeleton construction, and he says that it's the Masonic Temple by Burnham and Root in 1892. Or sort of says that sort of acknowledges that claim, says that that has, that that sounds legitimate to him. So we have all of this kind of very vague language, right? What is tall? Is that a quantifiable number? Is it 10 stories? Is it a slenderness ratio? We were saying this morning, I think my definition for tall is when you take a picture of it with your iPhone or you're holding a portrait or a landscape, right? Fundamentally, like, what's our basic sensibility? But that's really vague. And almost all of the other language here, except high-speed electric elevators, right? Skeleton construction is something, too, that we can argue about. What exactly is that? Well, the term itself, as everyone here knows, relates not only to sailing ships, which wouldn't have made much sense in Chicago, but all sorts of other things. So one of the things that I've done is to go back into the Chicago Tribune's archives, which are now kind of searchable, and look for all variants of the term skyscraper. And in Chicago, the term goes back to 1863, when it's used to describe ladies' hats, right? So a particularly tall hat is a skyscraper. Obviously, that's not no one debates like what the first skyscraping hat was, but here we go. My personal favorite is that sports writers use the term to describe home runs in the 1870s. So here, the Cincinnati's phenomenon was reduced to less than ordinary. National League fans will recognize that continues today. But the skyscraper is, again, something that's just really tall, right? A really, really high pop fly. Now, interestingly, the first time I found this used to describe buildings is in January 1899, and Carson Webster says this is when he starts to see it for the first time as well. And here, I love the title of this article. This is in the Chicago paper. Chicago skyscrapers, they are not beautiful, but are wonderfully solid and convenient and are absolutely fireproof. All right, so not beautiful. And here are the three that they're talking about, the Tacoma, the Owings, and the Chamber of Commerce building. And they say that it has to be a money-making scheme, so it has to be commercial. And it has to maximize light, convenience, and safety. And the Tribune, of course, says, well, Chicago already leads the world, and these three new structures will place it still farther ahead of all rivals. So this is in 1889, and they're discounting essentially kind of any building before then as a quote-unquote skyscraper, right? This is the first use of what's obviously a slang term applied to buildings in Chicago. Well, here are those three buildings. And the Tacoma, as I'll show, is kind of important in the technological advancement of one particular element that I think is worth talking about. The Owings and the Chamber of Commerce are both this kind of mix of masonry and steel construction. The Owings has got a great history. It's built on spec by a roller skating tycoon. There was such a thing in the 1880s. The Chamber of Commerce is a little bit more sober. None of these buildings, frankly, are totally satisfying. They're tall, they're slender, they're commercial, they use iron and steel to some extent or another. But I would argue that they don't look like what we think of as modern skyscrapers. And I'll get into why I think that is in a bit. They rely an awful lot, all three of them, on masonry. Now, interestingly, I went back just last week. I thought, well, you could do the same thing with the New York Press. And I went back into the New York Times archives, admittedly not the most progressive of newspapers in the 19th century. But the first thing I can find that talks about a skyscraper, quote unquote, in the New York Times, is in 1890, so a year and a half after the Tribune has used the term. And they're talking about a splendid bank building that I love this. The style is partly Renaissance, partly Italian. I'm not quite sure how you pronounce that. You know, fair enough, right? And the ceilings of the stories, it says it's only 8 floors, so it's got it's got some concerns about calling this a skyscraper, but the ceilings are really high. So again, we get into this, like, do you count just the total floors? Is it the total height of the building? And what building is this? It's the Manhattan Savings Institution building at Bleecker and Broadway that's still there, and it is certainly a tall, slender building. But again, I would argue, even though it's a skyscraper for the day, it doesn't reflect what we think of as a kind of modern skyscraper. There's not a lot of connection between the technology that goes into this and say a tall building that you were constructing today, right?
And it's on the same block as Louis Sullivan's Bayard Condit building, which is not a skyscraper.
Somehow not a skyscraper, right? So this is kind of a conundrum, right? We have the term coming into use in 1889, 1890, so I would argue that, hey, if the New York Times doesn't think of the Tribune building as a skyscraper, right, maybe something's not right there. But it applies to these buildings that have the proportions, have the function, but use means to get there that are, to my mind, very 19th century, right, relying very heavily on masonry. So my job is I have to come up with an argument, right? I have to kind of backfill and I have to find an argument for which there's a very clear Chicago winner. All right, and the architect here is going to take on the structural question, right? The engineer says that's not important. The architect is going to say it is. This is headline stuff. All right, well, let's look at Chicago's previous contender, right? Don actually showed you the Rookery building. I hate to do that, but the home insurance was just across the street, and it was about the same time. And so built in 1884, and as you can see, it was originally 10 stories, was later extended to 12. And you can see that on the inside, it's definitely got cast iron and wrought iron skeleton construction, fireproofed. It has high-speed elevators. And on the outside, you can see it has this kind of combination of brick and iron construction, right? The columns are buried within the brick. Now, the home insurance attracts a certain amount of attention. It's a relatively big building. It's in Chicago. And just to follow up on Don's point, home insurance is a New York company that gains a reputation after 1871 for being the first insurance company to pay off people who lost things in the fire. And as a result, it attracts more customers in Chicago and decides to build its Western headquarters there. So there is a connection to the fire. In the 1890s, a couple of things happened. Buffington files his patent, and Chicago architects are just slightly nervous about that. And Burnham in particular, Daniel Burnham in particular, writes letters to other architects in Chicago and says, do we have any defense against this? Are we going to have to pay this guy royalties? Buffington is really more of a patent troll, I would say, than anything else. And so there's a kind of kerfuffle trying to figure out like whether Chicago architects in particular can put forward a united front legally. The other thing that happens is the president of a steamship company writes to the Engineering Record in 1896 and says that they want to name a steamship after the inventor of, quote, lofty steel construction. And can the editors please tell them who was responsible for this? And the editors, I think, very soberly, very fairly say, well, we wrote about the home insurance building in 1884. We wrote about the Drexel building in Philadelphia in 1885. No one's from Philadelphia here presenting. And the Rookery in Chicago, which was built in 1887. And they sort of leave it there. And Jenny writes back. And he says, the skeleton construction was a radical departure from anything that had heretofore appeared and was, exclusively my invention. other architects have taken this and sort of fiddled with the details, but everything that makes the modern skeleton frame was found in the home insurance building. Oh, and by the way, if you go back and look at the sanitary engineer in December 1885, you'll find a full description of it. Chicago architects get behind this, in part because almost all of them have worked for Jenny at some time or another. Right? Jenny's a much beloved figure. By this point, he's kind of in the twilight of his career, and Burnham basically writes around saying, we should get behind him. Right? He kind of deserves this honor. And if we show that the home insurance was the first example of skeleton construction, we can get rid of this guy from Minneapolis who keeps asking us for royalties. So there are a number of letters that get published that say, yep, Jenny's right. He invented skeleton construction and the home insurance was the first one. Okay, well, if you go back to the sanitary engineer, December 1885, Iowa State has a full run of the sanitary engineer, and it's fascinating. But Jenny's article does in fact say that the piers between the windows were reduced to a minimum so they could bring light into the offices. This is part of the legend that, is apparently true. And he says iron was used as the skeleton of the entire building except the party walls, and every piece of iron was protected from fire by masonry. So this is a standard tenet of skeleton construction. The iron does the work, the masonry keeps it from the heat of the fire. I don't really understand this part, excepting only some columns not too dangerous if left exposed. I think every column is probably dangerous if it's exposed to fire. But anyway, moving on, he then kind of changes his language. A square iron column was built into each of the piers on the street fronts, which makes it sound like the brick pier is kind of already there in his mind, and the iron is really more like reinforcing. And then he just straight up lies. All columns and mullions were continuous from bottom plate to the top of ceiling. As Gerald Larson has shown, that's just garbage. Jenny didn't do that because he didn't want the lesser weight of the mullions to settle differentially from the columns. They actually were discontinuous. And then the girders carrying the I-beams to the floors rested on brackets on the iron columns. And this, I think, is a crucial distinction. The most important thing about this article, though, I think if you were trying to establish what Jenny actually did here, was Jenny talks about this in these few sentences. And the article he writes is several thousand words long, and he titles it not a new way of framing tall construction, he titles it construction of a heavy fireproof building on compressible soil. And most of the article actually relates to the foundations, how you float this building on clay in Chicago. So in 1885, Jenny doesn't seem to know what he's done, or maybe Jenny understands exactly what he's done and doesn't think it's that big a deal. Well, we can look at the building itself, and this is work that graduate students of mine did for the book. And we can see that it just structurally, it just feels very differently than any building we would do today. It is, in the words of one science writer in the 1980s, it's a crustacean, it's not a vertebrate. Right? The outside skin of the building is heavy and load-bearing and structural. It's the inside that's the kind of, you know, the crispy interior. It isn't something where the structure is all on the inside and the skin is just kind of hung on the outside. You can see that from the basic proportions, but you can also see it from this famous report that Thomas Talmadge led when the home insurance was destroyed in 1931-1932 to make way for the field building. Here they are in their OSHA-approved fedoras, looking at an example. You can see too the fall protection in the back. I love that. Right. Get away with that today. Here they are looking at a cast iron column, and one of the things they do is they take away some of the brick to prove, quote unquote, that it's the iron holding up the brick, right, and not the other way around. Of course, all this shows, and you can see too the scars on the cast iron, all this shows that the brick and the iron of the home insurance were working monolithically. If, as Jenny had claimed, the iron and brick were separated, that top brick would just fall right down, right? It would just slide down the column. And in fact, the two of them are adhered very closely together. Now, Talmadge's report was commissioned by the Marshall Field Estate, who were wrecking the home insurance to build what's now the field building. There's very clearly an idea that Talmadge is out to prove that the home insurance is the kind of birthplace of the skyscraper, right? This is where it all happened. The Field Estate is doing this thing of like wrecking a building and trying to prove how important the building that they're demolishing is. But it becomes this kind of like this kind of key document in the debate, right? Talmadge is Chicago's most noted historian, and he assembles this panel of architects and engineers who sort of nod and say, "Yep, this is it." At the same time, though. There's another commission, the Society of Western Engineers commissions a bunch of engineers to look at the building too, and they come up with slightly different findings. On the left is a detail of this model that my students built, and you can see that there's much, much more brick around that ironwork than you would ever need for just fireproofing. And in fact, the brick is doing several things. It's inevitably taking some of the gravity loads, whether that's intended or not, number one. Number two, it's stiffening the building against wind. The problem with cast and wrought iron is you can't get these very tight connections that you want in a because cast iron isn't workable. And you can see Jenny's detail there where the wrought iron girders are literally resting on the cast iron column, right? There's no solid connection between the two because you can't make precise holes in the cast iron to get the bolts to connect. So the brick is actually there not only to protect the iron against fire, it's there to stiffen the connections, right? And to keep the building basically from blowing over in a windstorm. Jenny writes absolutely nothing about this.
Are you saying that those connections have no mechanical connection?
You can see there is one mechanical connection, and it's literally a pin that's driven through a hole in the wrought iron girder and a cast hole in the cast iron column.
No different than a timber frame.
Probably less stiff than a typical connection in timber, right? And that explains the tight masonry jackets around it. So here's the conclusion of the report from the Western Society of Engineers. The steel skeleton was self-supporting. That's two lies in one. It's an iron skeleton, and it was not self-supporting. Everything else, though, is pretty cogent. The load, they think, was divided between the columns and the piers. So the brick and iron both carried the load. The wind load was carried. The masonry, as the steel work, again, sick, was not designed to take wind bending. It wasn't a curtain wall. The masonry had to start at the base and then go up. And in fact, the first two stories of the home insurance are bearing stone. No one makes much mention of that, but it's true. And then finally, the walls, they say, were not of the curtain type, but were the ordinary bearing type. And the designer, they say, was unwilling to give up the strength and security of heavy masonry walls for, and I think this is the crucial phrase, the curtain walls and steel wind bracing of the modern skeleton building. Right? Mm-hmm. So buried in this report, I think, is a formula for what the modern skeleton building would be. And this, I'm going to argue, is maybe a kind of more useful definition than anything we've seen so far. All right, well, having demolished Chicago's traditional claim on the first skyscraper, where are we going with this? Well, the Tacoma building, one of those three buildings that the Tribune first calls a skyscraper, makes one really important kind of technical innovation. And that is that they take the masonry shear walls that have always been around the outside of the building, that were essentially a lot of the shear resistance for home insurance, and they turn them inside, right? You can see one of the shear walls there that's basically taken a masonry wall on the outside of the building and just turned it 90 degrees so that it's poking in instead of running along the walls. And what that allowed Halliburton Roche to do was to skin the building with a lightweight terracotta and glass curtain wall. And this, at least in Chicago, is the first example I can find of a skin of a building that's literally held on the outside of the structure. And the Tribune loses its mind over this. It thinks that the building looks too fragile, that it's going to come down. But you can see what the owner gets out of it, right? All of the shear resistance now gets sort of sucked into the building, and the exterior now can be almost entirely, by the standards of the day, glass, right? You can let in all of this daylight to the interior. Now, Tacoma, therefore, is still a hybrid building structurally, but it makes this advance in terms of the building cladding. It separates the structure and the skin of the building in a way that feels new, and certainly gets remarked upon. The other thing that happens is that Chicago, as you can see from these quotes, uses steel more aggressively, sooner than New York. Jenny points out in 1891 that cast iron with, quote, ingenious devices to tie the beams rigidly to the columns, and by that he means literally just like pins, Notice that as soon as riveted steel could be done for any affordable price, 1885 is the year we traditionally associate with the Bessemer process, and it takes a couple of years to work its way into the market. Jenny says all column connections by 1891 in Chicago are made with hot rivets. And basically, he says that we now build skyscrapers like we build steel railroad bridges. Engineering News, which I should point out is a New York publication, 6 years later makes the conclusion that cast iron isn't reliable in tall building construction because you can't get the stiffness in the frame out of it. And they admit, the architects of Chicago seem to have reached this conclusion, those of New York City have had sufficient experience to maybe satisfy themselves of the wisdom of it. So there's this kind of, Chicago kind of jumps ahead in the use of steel. Steel has this kind of sweet spot where it's almost as strong as cast iron in compression, stronger than wrought iron in tension, but it's ductile. And what this means is that instead of these very loose connections that you get in cast iron, you can rivet steel girders and columns to one another. And you can take all of the gravity and all of the lateral loads and compress them onto the actual frame of the building. You don't need the exterior to do any of the work. So Don and I both agree that the Manhattan has a kind of claim on this. It's certainly the first all-steel building in Chicago. It uses cross-bracing, or it used cross-bracing to achieve its stiffness. A report in the 70s found out that the owners of the shops on the first floor had removed all of this pesky cross-bracing. And in fact, the building had this kind of inherent stability because of its partition walls that fortunately have kept it in one piece. The Manhattan building, it's got a lot of masonry in it, not only in the party walls that you see at the end, but also in the skin itself. It's a relatively heavy skin, and the Masonic Temple is taller. And so the folks who are claiming the Masonic Temple are making a kind of value judgment here. The Masonic Temple is taller, it's not more slender, but it has a kind of more vertical appearance. And you can see its wind truss system on the interior is extensive. It's literally like a bridge that's kind of turned up on its end. Well, to my mind, that's still not quite there. That's a self-braced steel frame, but it's still a masonry building. And the New York Times, writing about Chicago architecture in 1892, says, oh, well, the latest fad is to build these flimsy, quote, veneered buildings. Right? The brick that you're seeing there isn't structural, it's just a, quote, veneer. And the implication, of course, is that Chicago buildings are kind of cheap, kind of tawdry. You know, they're not solid brick like we're still building in New York. They use this kind of steel that's a little bit questionable. And the idea of a veneer, to me, disqualifies this from being really modern, right? We don't put a kind of fake brick, well, not usually, on the outside of our tall buildings, right? We use glass. And as I was talking about Wednesday night, but just to sort of make the point quickly, there's a weird kind of quirk in the plate glass industry where a lot of it moves to central Indiana in the early 1890s to service the Chicago market directly. And you see this drop in the price of plate glass in Chicago, and right away you see these buildings that kind of explode with plate glass over the surfaces. So the Reliance building in 1895 is a self-braced, moment-framed steel structure with this very, very thin skin of glass and terracotta on the outside of its two fronts. The party walls you see are a brick curtain wall, so it's still a heavy construction to separate it from its neighbors. Barbara Faree, New York critic, writing in the Modern Office Building.
I was just saying to Don, he's my favorite.
Well, he's and any New York partisan will love Barbara Faree because he thinks of Chicago buildings as kind of cheap garbage, right? The Reliance Building is the most notable attempt yet made to reduce the amount of enclosing material to a minimum. He talks about the Fisher Building, which I'll get to in a second, and the Mabley Building in Detroit. Okay, well, Detroit can't be the birthplace of the skyscraper, so we're going to ignore that one. And he says that these buildings may be firm and strong, but they don't look firm and strong, right? So the reliance is something that violates all notions of kind of good taste to Faree. The Fisher building, I think, is a particularly interesting one. It comes right after the Reliance. It's kind of the big, unheralded brother to the Reliance. It's Charles Atwood's last design. He dies of opium addiction while the building is being built. So it's got a good story to it. It explains a lot, doesn't it? And the Fisher building has the same formula as the Reliance, a self-braced, mono-frame steel structure, a terracotta and glass skin, and its firewall, quote unquote, on the back, is light terracotta. The owners of the Fisher buy the air rights to the lot next to them, and they don't have to put this heavy brick curtain wall on the outside. So there's the moment frame structure, there's the curtain wall going up from the second floor, so the first floor stays open. And when the building gets written about by Inland Architect, they say, this is the first building in human history that's being built without walls. And they mean without masonry, right? There's no brick in the building structure. There's no brick in the building skin. And I'm going to argue that relates very clearly to the way we build tall buildings today in a way that buildings just a couple of years earlier do not. We don't use brick for anything other than kind of aesthetic purposes or maybe partition purposes in skyscrapers today. The Fisher building is the first one to get rid of brick entirely in both the structure and the skin. And so I'm gonna sort of throw it down and say that in addition to these four kind of traditional historical definitions of the skyscraper, that the Western Society of Engineers in 1932 came up with this very, very cogent formula of a tall building, whatever that means, supported entirely by an internal frame, let's not say steel because concrete becomes important as well, and with a lightweight, non-bearing skin. And if we accept that brick is not lightweight, then the Reliance, which is maybe a more popular building, gets nixed as well. And this kind of unheralded underdog of a building, the Fisher, in 1896, is, I think, the first building to kind of match this formula. That formula applies to buildings in subsequent generations. So even though people's gas in Chicago, for instance, is a solid skin, it's a solid terracotta skin that's only a few inches deep. And you can see that it's on a braced frame as well. That definition applies to the building that I think kind of wrests the title of like most advanced skyscraper city from Chicago for a while. And the Woolworth building, I think the definition applies as well. So, and you can keep going, right? In the 50s, the same definition applies. Framed building, lightweight skin on the exterior, all of the structure being kind of sucked into the frame, and the skin being something that literally just encloses it. So I'll leave it there. I'll plug this kind of alternate history, and also this debate Don and I have been having for 10 years, sometimes on my blog, which is Architecture Farm. At the risk of being run out of town on a rail, I can say even if I've convinced you that Chicago is actually the home of the first skyscraper, we can continue this kind of fun kind of rivalry between the two cities by talking about things like, what's the tallest building in North America, right? I'll leave it there, thanks.
Depends on how you measure it, absolutely. So maybe to continue standing up rather than sitting down, if you don't mind. And
sure.
Hey, Lee Gray, why don't you come up and say a word about Whitlaw Reed's tall tower, the Tribune building, just to respond to the first part of their discussion. And unless you stand in front of the images, you're not going to be on our video. So, maybe. So Lee Gray is going to speak in the first session in the afternoon. But I don't think you can see. Are they still in the video?
No.
You can move over there.
Move it. Block that slide.
But since partner in argument with with Don to look back at the all the way back in 1874 and taller than the Fisher Building. Do you want, we wanted to talk a little bit about the logic of that definition.
Well, the, I guess a key thing I would add, and it's unfortunate we don't have this image, Whitlaw recommissioned an image in, I think it was 1874. The building is under construction. It was published in the Tribune Almanac, and it's an engraving looking over the top of the fountain in City Hall Park, showing the Tribune Tower. And that image was important because there's the Tribune Tower, and then there's the sun, and then there's the Times. And it was yeah. You know, it was clearly commissioned, you know, my newspaper building is taller than yours. And
it's
that
right here,
drives.
By the way. I mean, that's not the one.
That's but not the one. But it, and it appears in the Tribune Almanac is important because then it goes out to all of, quote, his people. And this is something that I know many of you know, but you know, this was a point in time when, not unlike today, depending on your political persuasion is how you got your news. You know, if you were a Tribune reader, you didn't read the Times, and you certainly didn't read the New York Sun. So, you know, there was a partisanship to this, and that image is very important because it's all about height. You know, this is going to be the tallest building in this part of the city. So it's that. And I don't know if there's similar images in Chicago that have that kind of power. It's the earliest one that I found that drives home that the point on that you made about, you know, this is taller than anything else. The engraving of the Equitable Building doesn't have that character to it because it's only 130 feet. But I mean, the, you know, the image of the Western Union is sort of like that, but it's missing the context that's in that very particular image.
I'd like to make sort of, this is partly a response to Tom, but it's just a sort of a meta discussion in a way. One way of judging the criteria that you choose to use to define skyscrapers, Tom's slide with the different criteria, is what's included and what's excluded. In other words, look at the results of using your criteria and say, not do I like those results, but do those results make sense? And for example, the Chrysler Building, a New York building, tallest in the world for about a year, has a solid brick exterior. And Tom's definition says a brick wall doesn't work. So if you're excluding the Chrysler Building as a skyscraper, maybe there's something funny with your criteria. But I mean, putting it in Chicago terms, I personally would not accept the definition of skyscraper that excludes the Monadnock Building and the Rookery and a number of other iconic Chicago skyscrapers. And as soon as you say you have to have the steel skeleton frame and the curtain wall, those buildings drop out.
Sure.
So, you know, and this, I'm not arguing pick the criteria to get the results you want. I'm arguing if the results seem very peculiar, maybe you should look at your criteria again.
Sure. Well, maybe the Chrysler Building's not it. Yeah, I mean, that's absolutely right. And, you know, the reason I think lightweight is trying to, is sort of a post-rationalization, right? I'd like it to not be the reliance, because I'd like it to be a surprise. And I think that the, I think though that there is a difference between a skyscraper and a modern skyscraper.
Yes.
And I think that that's what the Western Society of Engineers report really brings home, is that there is a big difference between the Monadnock and the Reliance or the Fisher buildings. And I think that in that gap, you know, between 1892 and 1895, things, or you know, there's enough confidence in the steel frame, enough confidence in the curtain wall, that the way we think about skyscrapers changes in an important way. So first skyscraper, there's maybe not a good answer to. First modern skyscraper, I think, might be a better question to ask. At least it's one that gets me the answer that I want. and so I think it's worth thinking about it in that way.
The other point I made to Tom when I was whispering in his ear earlier, is that a lot of buildings with terracotta facades have very thick, heavy walls. Woolworth Building is famous for having enormously heavy masonry walls, so much so that one, they have damaged themselves. They're much stiffer than the steel frame, and therefore they took a lot of structural load that they were never supposed to carry, and that was destroying the terracotta. And it has been addressed several times now. It finally seems to be on a good footing. But there was facade damage being caused because the walls were so thick that they inadvertently acted as structure. Just because it's terracotta doesn't mean it's light.
Right, sure.
And just because it's brick doesn't mean it's heavy, I guess it's the corollary.
Yeah.
There's also the whole complication of Kelly's building, which is all concrete, as I understand it. The Twin Towers in Kuala Lumpur.
There's a lot of concrete. There's a lot of very tall concrete frame buildings.
That's, yeah.
But they fall into the same category of skeleton frames that support all the loads. So it's just it's a different type of skeleton that looks different, but that concrete frame is a skeleton frame.
Okay. Kind of a two-part question. First, you keep using the phrase moment frame.
Mm-hmm.
If you could define that a little more,
sure.
Specifically what that means. And also, in your book, you kind of refute some of what you're saying in terms of with the Reliance and Fisher buildings, that after that, there was kind of a hiatus of that technology.
Mm-hmm.
That the masonry technology is really what dominated the kind of second and third phases of skyscraper construction. And it's really not until the 50s that that sense of the frame that you're talking about really becomes important again.
Right, that's true. So let me answer both these, and Don can jump in if I get lost in moment framing. But there are a couple of ways to keep a building frame from racking in the wind. And the kind of bridge approach is to cross brace it. So you make a rectangle into triangles, and the triangles can't change shape, right, without bending the actual material. Or you can take that rectangle and you can make the corners really, really rigid, right, much more rigid than the material itself. What happens then is that for the wind to change the building shape, again, it has to actually bend the columns and the girders, right? It can't rack like that. So a moment frame is basically taking the columns and the girders and expanding, making them a little bit bigger and kind of intersecting them in a way that you can get a really, really stiff connection so that when the wind tries to bend the building, it has to, like the relationship between the girder and the column stays perpendicular. And so all of the material that makes up the columns and the girders has to bend in order for the building to move at all, right? So it's basically just a really, really big, really stiff connection. And the advantage is that you don't have cross bracing or portals or anything getting in the way of your interior planning. So, and the Reliance, Don may disagree with me, but E.C. Shankland, who's Burnham's chief engineer, realizes that with riveted connections, you know, for the first time in a building structure, you can actually get a true moment frame where all of the joints are just these really stiff internal joints and you don't have to have any of the cross bracing.
Just an addendum to that would be that that's why you don't see moment frames until you have all steel framing, because you cannot make a rigid connection using cast iron. There were literally one or two wrought iron moment frame buildings, but by the time that people were ready to build those buildings, the price of steel had dropped so much that wrought iron was dead. So it could have been done in wrought iron had steel technology developed slower, but it was the end of cast iron. And just before I forget, I know you have a second half of that question to answer. The quote about the unreliability of cast iron was part of an article describing the collapse of a building with cast iron columns. So the point that they were making, and I happen to know that article because it's showed up in my research, what was happening in New York, this did not happen in Chicago, where steel drove out cast iron pretty rapidly. What happened in New York is the practice bifurcated, and you had people building big office buildings using steel frames that looked very much like Chicago buildings, and you had people building apartment houses and factories using cast iron columns that were considered to be, by 1897, by engineers, very old-fashioned. So that was the engineering news saying, We got to stop doing this. Look at these much better buildings over here that other people are building.
Yeah. And by over here, you mean?
A block away in New York, never mind Chicago. No, seriously, they were saying, we know how to do this properly. Look at these buildings in New York. You know, and why do we continue to do something that we know is no good? And the answer actually is economics.
So just to answer the second half of the question, so these buildings, the Fisher is really the last of the curtain wall buildings, because the getting rid of all the brick is great if you're anyone but a bricklayer. And what happens is the code changes. It's influenced by the bricklayers union. The code changes, and fireproofing of skeleton frames has to get bulkier, and it gets bulkier to a dimension that's exactly that of a U.S. common brick. And so for, you know, 30 or 40 years, or well, I guess not, maybe more like 15 years, you see the kind of classic Chicago frame, which is basically that code formula adopted to the steel frame. And it's not until other things change that you start to see these solid curtain walls that kind of conceal that depth of fireproofing.
Mm-hmm. Was Paxton the first person to do a curtain wall?
Or a cathedral builder in 980 AD, you know, had to find a curtain wall. You know, I'm always going to come back to that same definitional problem. If you're saying it's a non-structural wall, there are plenty of non-structural walls in ancient buildings. As a matter of fact, the phrase curtain wall, its oldest use in the U.S. is in forts, where you have the bastions are the strong part of the fort, and in between them is the curtain wall, which has to be protected by the bastions. So if you want to talk about glass curtain walls, look at the old cathedrals and tell me it's not. It's just not that you can't build a whole building that way because the stone technology doesn't work. But you can certainly build a very large section of wall that way. And people did.
It seems to me that there's a very big philosophical discussion that's sort of embedded in here. Tom touched on a little, and there's also a huge elephant in the room, which is the modern movement, the modernist movement, which also Tom sort of touched on, but I think it's worth sort of elucidating that it really goes down to, like, what's the most important thing about a building? Is it the way it's built? Or is it the sort of look and effect and appearance and emotional aesthetic and power of the past? And architects and engineers tend to think the way it's built is very, very important. And modernist architects and engineers felt that it was almost the only thing, in a way. It was the absolutely crucial thing about it. And then there's a sense in which I feel they sort of, particularly in the 1940s and 50s, and even starting in the 30s, there was a kind of retroactive thing about the origins of the modernist skyscraper, which then led back to Chicago. And SYMPOSIUM comes along with the beginnings of a completely different idea, which is one I sort of do kind of agree with myself, that the skyscraper, if it had only been about technological improvements and stacking people up, would have been important. But the emotional and aesthetic power of the modern skyline as this collection, this amazing collection of tall towers next to each other, sort of took over the imagination of the world. And that really had nothing to do, per se, with how the, you know, what the relationship of how light the curtain wall was in relation. And it was perfectly allowable for the Chrysler Building to have a brick curtain wall. Sure, it couldn't have been built that tall if it was masonry. Yeah. But the New York tradition was the effect is the most important thing, the power of the effect of the skyline of buildings. And because of steel, we can make them really tall. And that reigned for the teens, as you say, Woolworth, and all through the 20s and 30s and 40s, really. And then it starts to go the other way, and modernism rises. And they go, oh, those pastiche, picturesque buildings, which were actually made of steel, but they looked like they were made of masonry, and God knows what else in the case of the Chrysler Building. And we're going to go to these honest, simple buildings. So now there's this kind of movement. Where did that all begin? And, you know, so it's an argument between two cities. But it seems to me it's a very large philosophical argument about what's important about tall buildings in particular, but buildings in general. And I find it, I love the, you know, the conversation, it's really fantastic, but I think that needs to be said. I certainly felt as an architect in the 1970s, when we were sort of at the beginnings of sort of postmodernism, a kind of great sympathy for Wiseman's argument.
Sure, sure.
And as the person, I've just also written a book about New York and its power in the movies, is, you know, when people, when you see the skyline in an opening shot of a film, it's not, you know, the power of it is absolutely worldwide and popular. It's the most powerful modern architectural form, arguably, certainly most widespread. And yet, it has nothing necessarily to do with these particular arguments about competence. And arguably, the old sort of aesthetically powerful buildings that Wiseman were emotionally powerful buildings later. Yeah.
Just add to support Jane's point, and like we all took the same classes in graduate school, and the book that was assigned to, sounds counterintuitive, but to teach you about modern architecture was Siegfried Gideon's Space, Time, and Architecture.
Right. Well, and so two sort of answers to that. One is that Chicago's skyline has been iconic for a long time, and it's easier to get a photograph of it than New York's, because you can just row a boat out on the lake, right, as far as you want. But you don't see, like, you know, an avid collector of kind of old images, and you don't actually see the skyline as a skyline until after the 1922 code, which lets buildings go up past the 260 whatever foot cornice line, and basically is inspired by or is trying to kind of imitate New York's code. And it's only after that sort of first few years of buildings go up that you start to get these postcards where someone has gone out in a rowboat and just taken a picture of Chicago's skyline. So I think that's absolutely right. And, you know, no one is going to take a picture of a flat corniced Michigan Avenue, right? It's consistent, but it's kind of dull. And I think, you know, the point about Gideon, Gideon is one of these people who is trying to find a kind of ancestry for modernism. And the spread that I sometimes open lectures with is the one where on one page you have the Reliance Building, and on the facing page you have Mies van der Rohe's 1922 glass curtain wall. And Gideon is basically saying, you know, Americans didn't know what they had. It took Germans to sort of realize the potential in that. And, you know, to me, that's misreading the complexity, right? I think that the aesthetics are important, but I think the technology is important too. And I think what's interesting today is that you don't get people in, sort of fully in one camp or another, right? I think we all acknowledge that it's a much more complicated story about the technology, the aesthetics, the economics, the, you know, sociocultural, the politics, you know, all of that makes for a kind of soup. It means we can talk about it endlessly.
Forever,
which is kind of nice.
I'd like to prove that I am gradually turning into my grandfather by answering your question with an anecdote. About 20 years ago, I went to do a house alteration in Westchester County. And I got off the train and walked for about half a mile. I was at the house. I was walking up the street, and I knew I was looking at the right building. I'm like, somebody hired Corbusier to design a house in Westchester? And I think, that can't be right. And I got closer, and it wasn't. It was a very, very clever copy of Corbusier's style. And I thought, this is interesting. I haven't worked on a concrete house. And then I got inside the house and started poking around, and it was all 2x6s and 2x10s and stucco. And what they had done was perfectly capture this modernist style using the traditional materials to build a house. So I think that whoever built that house, and presumably the owners knew that they were living in a wood frame house, whoever built the house and the owners of the house were perfectly happy to have the aesthetic without the technology that was the driving philosophy behind the aesthetic. Right? They completely divorced Corbusier's interest in the way that the thing was built from his visual aesthetic, and they were fine with it. And as an engineer, I was fine with it as well, because I was just there to work on the house.
In architecture school, I saw one of the most shocking sections I ever saw. And it was the section through Philip Johnson's glass house, revealing the dirty secret of Philip Johnson's glass house, which is its wood frame. And of course, when you stop to think about it, it would have to be. Mm-hmm. Because if you built it out of actual steel, like it looks,
it couldn't possibly be held up by those tiny little columns. So the building complete, you know, it's a complete contradiction and is actually kind of secretly a wood frame house.
And the reason I bring up this anecdote is to not necessarily the people in this room, I mean, this is a self-selected group, right? The people who are here. But to the average person, they look at what the building looks like, and you know, it doesn't work. Before it was overhauled, One Central Park West, which I will always think of as the Gulf and Western building, regardless of what it's gone through three name changes since, that building had to basically be evacuated whenever there was a high wind because it moved so much that people were uncomfortable being in it. It was never going to fall over. It was not serviceable. It moved too much. So people care about that, and they care about what it looks like. They care about the layouts. Does it work for them? But they don't care about the structural issues that we're talking about. They don't care about how it was built. So if you ask, a normal person, if you ask the average person about a skyscraper, they're not going to talk about anything we're talking about here today. They might talk about what they know about history and materials, right? If they have the second grader from Chicago's understanding of building structure, they'll start talking about the home insurance building was a steel skeleton frame building, which is something you can find all over the internet. They don't care that they're wrong because that's their understanding of the way these buildings work.
And the Villa Savoy is actually Carusi's villas, a lot of them are actually brick.
Yeah.
With stucco.
Still a notch up from two bys.
Yeah, maybe.
Is there not one last question? Because actually this space needs to be transformed back into a gallery exhibition by noon today. So we're going to reconvene over at 26 Broadway. I hope everybody knows how to walk back over to 26 Broadway, and the check-in there will begin, well, there'll be somebody downstairs with the RSVP list at about 12:40 until 1 o'clock, and we'll start at 1 o'clock there again. Before we thank our speakers, let me ask you to help out with a little bit of housekeeping. That is, somewhere we have a trolley for these chairs. So if you put your chair on the trolley, we'll be able to have a space clear enough to put our gallery tables and our map back in place and look like a museum again. So thank you, speakers.
Thank you.